Let's take a look at how we can quickly customize Blender's interface to make it suitable to our needs as industrial designers. Let's set actually the preferences first. We go to User Preferences. In Editing, we can increase the undo steps to 64. We can go to Input, Left. If we are on a laptop, we want to click Emulate Numpad. Then we can go to File, select Compress File and System, and set this one to 16, this one on 16, and this one on. Okay, good. Then we actually want to adjust the way how the interface looks. So go from a mouse to those markers, and you see how it's changing from a mouse to a plus. Left mouse button, click, hold, drag down, and you should see this arrow. A common mistake is at the beginning, students click and move the mouse up, and if I move it up, then actually I slice my viewport. Of course, you want to click and move down there. Then, here, for example, I can drag this one over. I would like this one to move up, so I go to here and join this. Change this one to the 3D viewport. Right mouse button, click, flip to top, and here change this one to properties. There. Okay, nearly there. Then we can press A and A to deselect and select everything. Press X to delete. Now here's my 3D cursor. I would like to go into an orthographic view, so I press 5 on my numpad, and you see up here it switches to orthographic. I would like to change this 3D cursor to be at the world center, so I can press N. Go to 3D cursor and type in 000. And then to set our world unit system, I can go to the property panel, to the scene, and use, for example, Imperial. And at this point, I'm pretty close. I want to change this one to cycles. And I can go to File, click Save Startup File, and then every time when you quit Blender or you start it, everything will be exactly like this. I'm simply going to create a new document because this is the way how I themed my environment. Let's delete this one. Let's go back to Imperial. Okay, so we, for example, are going to rebuild the table simply as an exercise. So, for example, I see I'm in top view, so this is good. My 3D cursor is at the center. Right mouse button click by accident changes it to somewhere else. So, in case you do that, you can always set it back by going to the 3D cursor. Now we would like to create a table, for example, which is 34, let's say 36 inches deep and 80 inches wide. So I can press Shift A and go to Plane. I could also go to Add Mesh Plane, or I go to Create Plane. It's all actually the same. So, plane, and then there's my object. If I take a look up here inside the property panels with N, I can show and hide it. I have an information for transform, so location, rotation, scale, and dimension. For example, here I see this one is 2 feet wide and 2 feet tall. So, X, maybe let's say we do 74 inches, and Y maybe 36 inches. So you see, I can actually write the values right into it. It's pretty nice. And let's say this one should be how tall, maybe, for example, there we could type in 38 inches. Okay. Now, by having this plane created and then scaled it, we also see it has a scale factor. So for X and Y. And we do not really want a scale factor. We want the brute, how can I say that? Size. So what does scale factor actually mean? So hold on. So this one should be Y 3 feet. I go into edit mode, length, and if I zoom in, you can actually see here it says it's hard to read, but it says actually 2 feet because this is also 2 feet. So what's happening here is simply we have a 2 feet by 2 feet object, which artificially we scale to those dimensions. So we want to apply that. So we go to apply scale. There it is. Okay. So you see this is all set to 1 and those values, the dimensions are the same. But now you see when I select those parts, the values are correct. This one is 1 inch thick. So I can, for example, in this case, create myself a modifier. Go to add, solidify, and say 1 inch, and actually go up. And you see with the offset, my part is moving up and down. Maybe even thickness. Perfect. Okay, good. Then maybe I would like to create a leg. Now I have my 3D cursor somewhere here. So I could, for example, reset all this to 0. I could also, for example, create a plane. So Shift A plane. And then now this one is 2 inch by 2 inch. Now this object is totally misplaced, but wherever this 3D cursor actually is, that is where my object will be inserted. But because we insert objects in object mode, I can override the location and, for example, set this one to 0. Alternatively, I could also have set the location for the 3D cursor to 0, Shift A, another plane. Same thing, basically. Okay. This one, for example, let's press 7 to go into a top view. And you're going to see what's actually really nice when I zoom into. I see actually the grid being updated. It's actually pretty functional. And maybe I would like this one to line up with those edges. This might be a good opportunity to show you how the move command works. I can press those arrows to move along X and Y. If I press on this white ring, I can move it freely. I can also press G for X, G for move, and then I press X or Y. Let me go actually into perspective mode. So G, X, Y, or Z, up and down. Also, when I press R and Y, you see Y axis, X, X axis, Z, X axis, and even scale X, Y, and Z doesn't work in our case. So this is actually very simple. So you can press G to move and then freely or use XYZ for axes restrictions, or you can simply click on those widgets. Okay, so I would like this edge to snap to here, this edge snap to there. Snapping in Blender works basically based on the grid, the vertex point, an edge, or a face. In my case, I select edge, and the way now how the snapping works is I can press this arrow or press G and X, and then I have to move my mouse to where it should snap to, and then I press Control and I roll over that geometry, and you see then it snaps. So press the Y arrow, move my mouse to where it should snap to something, press Control and hold it, really important. So you should see this ring, release my mouse button, and I'm done. Perfect. Now, because everything is built on inches, I could, for example, now turn on the grid and, for example, press Control and snap and move it along grids. So now I moved it, this one in 2 inches by 2 inches, 3 inches. See, this is actually pretty nice. Alternatively, I could also press G, X, and then you would think, hey, 3 inches. Nope, doesn't work. So what we have to do, think about Excel, so G, X, then on the numpad, I punch in equal, and you see actually where my mouse is there. There's the equal and then 0 feet along the x-axis. So now I type in 3 and then inches. Go back to there, negative, and enter. So for example, y, g, y equal negative 3 inches. And there, it's the same. So you have actually to press the equal sign. So I do this one more time, and G, then you decide the axis, and then you can either enter a factor for scaling, but what I want, or for moving, what I want is simply to be precise of measurements. So I switch into math mode, press equal 1 inch. And you see there, it moves over 1 inch. And what's actually nice up here, you see where my mouse is, I can override actually the stuff, maybe 0.5 or maybe 0.25. So that's the reason why I said this is pretty much like working with formulas in Excel. It's actually pretty nice. I'm gonna press Escape, don't wanna do this. Okay, so this one I would like to extrude. So I could, for example, give this one a modifier. Nope. 3 feet there and straight there. So this one is this high. So copy and paste does it. Okay. So here you see I'm driving this leg by the length actually of my I'm driving the length of this leg by the value I entered. But maybe that's not the way how I want to do it. So to give you a little bit more exposure to the way how Blender works, I'm going to remove this solidify modifier. And again, those modifiers are like construction history features, like an alias. You will actually see there's a lot of overlap the way how alias works and how Blender works, which is the really nice part about it. So I didn't actually say how to rotate. So with shift middle mouse button and middle mouse button, if you drag and hold it, for example, you can rotate the view and then pan the view and middle mouse button to scroll. That's actually the zoom, by the way. And also the views, just to repeat it based on your notes, on your numpad, 7, 1, and 3 are the different views. And with 5, for example, you switch perspective or the graphic. And all these commands we actually have inside the main menu. So for example, here I have top view. Here I have add object or add mesh. Here I have deselect, select, select inverse. And here are all my objects menus. Okay, so let's go into this view maybe. I would like to extrude this one up. So what I do, this is now actually quite different than alias. I have something here called object mode and edit mode. And in edit mode, I can extrude and work with mesh, and cut mesh, and object mode, and basically move all these objects around. So in alias, basically, we can show and hide CVs. So here it's a little bit different. Just to tell you why we have edit mode and object mode is, you see here's this orange dot there as well. That's actually kind of like the center of an object. Now the object is like a container into which we put in mesh. And then to edit the mesh, we have to go into, well, edit mode. So that's what I'm going to do with this one here. Edit. Then I can press E, for example, move this one up, left mouse button, and then I'm going to click on vertex for the snap, click on the blue line, move my mouse to somewhere below there, and then press control. Maybe I have to zoom in a little bit and zip there. Press control. So you see I'm snapping to the lower point. Release my left mouse button. Release control. And there I'm good. See? Easy peasy. Okay. That was lag number one. Let's make a copy of this one. So Shift D. Then I press escape because I do not by accident want to move it. And I want to mirror it over down here. Now currently the nice thing is because everything is built perfectly at the center, I could simply go to Y here and say minus. And then Shift D, minus, and Shift D, and I have a positive there. Now we basically have all those lags. When we press the Z key, we switch between shaded mode and wireframe mode. Okay. So let's say we actually would like to have a crossbar. So I'm building this one in a way how maybe we would manufacture this part. So for example, I do something different first. Nope, never mind. Changed my mind. Okay. So here I press Shift D, press Escape. I don't want to move it. But now I press R, and in my case, X, and then 90. Okay. Undo. RX minus 90. And you see I rotated this part over just a notch. And maybe now I'm working with the grids and simply snap it on the grids, maybe 6 inches high, up 1 inch over there. And because this one is snapped to the grid, I can also now here grid snap, for example, this one back. There you see, now I have built this crossbar. So maybe Shift D, move this one up. And in this case, we are going to use the snapping again. So this object I would like to snap right below. So I click on X, left mouse button, hold, drag, press and hold Control, move my mouse to a snap target, release my mouse button, and I'm done. Let's say this one is somewhere here. Then there I do the same. Press on this Y, hold my mouse button, move my mouse to where to snap to, press Control, hold Control, find the snap target, release my mouse, press Tab to leave edit mode, and I'm done. So you see with Tab, actually I can switch between those edit modes and object mode. Pretty easy. So this one, for example, I would like to go along this bar. So I press Shift D, R, Z, 90, oh, perfect. And then now I'm just using the snapping for the mesh. You see in object mode and in edit mode, I'm zip, snap it over. I would like to bring this one over to there. So Shift D and then change the value here. Shift D, going to X, negative. So that's actually a really nice way to work with geometry when you really pay attention to your grid and the coordinate system. It really helps dramatically. Okay. There's kind of like our very, very basic computer table with a small metal support below, and then, for example, a top plate on top there. So I could, for example, further now maybe simulate edge roundings and welds, you know, and that's a manufacturing outcome. The welds we don't really design or build in CAD, so that part, for example, we have to ignore or build differently, which, for example, would also be the difference between a concept model and the manufacturing model. So what I'm going to do now in this case is maybe show you a little bit about polygonal modeling. So we're going to rebuild this whole part, the undercarriage, just with a different modeling approach. But let me actually show you first some ways how to hide objects. So I can click an object, press H to hide, Alt H, unhide. Press an object, press H, hide, press Alt H, unhide. Perfect. Let's hide this one. I can select an object by shift clicking on it or shift clicking, deselecting it. So I'm holding shift and left click. I can also press C, mouse wheel, actually changes the radius, and then I can brush over objects, or middle mouse button, brush over again, and then it deselects. So left mouse button, it adds, middle mouse button, it deselects. I could also press B and make a big selection with left mouse button, adds, B, middle mouse button, it removes. Easy. Or A, select everything. Now I would like to move everything here onto this layer. So I go to add, to object, move to layer, click the second layer. And you see now I have this yellow point. That means there's an object which is active. So I click it, there it is. See, quite easy. Okay, good. I'm going to this and this. I'm going to press Shift D, press Escape, go to Object, Move, or you could press M and move it back onto layer 1. To see different layers, you can simply left mouse button click on them, or with Shift add more layers or remove layers. Perfect. Okay, so what I would like to do right now is actually fuse all the stuff together. Now, what I have here is actually a pretty nice concept model for me to work as a reference sketch. So what I'm going to do is here I'm going to edit mode, and I move this one down, go to vertex maybe for the snapping, press this blue line, hold control key and snap to there. Then I press E and control click and snap to there. Press E, extrude it out, press control. Now I have to zoom in more. Control there, E, control up there. Awesome. Okay, perfect. Then maybe what I do here, you see I have something called point select. See up here I have all points selected, which means all edges are selected, which means also the faces selected. I can select those faces, sorry, edges. Or I can simply select a face. And you see when I select a face, all edges and points are selected. When I select two points, also this edge is selected because they are connected. Makes sense. Now I go to point select, press Z for wireframe, select this face, press E and press control and snap, for example, for that end. So you see I'm actually using those objects I created to simply sketch new geometry over it. So here I press E, control there. Maybe in this case I go to edge, E, control to, yeah, there it works. Perfect. And then this face, E, control there, E, and control, E, and control, and then that last face there, E, and zip. Okay, now this part there is open yet. That's on purpose because there I actually wanted to show you an additional command. So, for example, if I go into edit mode, I can select this face, rotate my view, select this face, go to mesh face. Let's see where it actually is hidden here. Where are you? Bridge, bridge, bridge. There. It's under edges there. So you could also press Shift E. No, was it Control E? Edges and bridge. You could also type in spacebar, bridge. And when you select it, what happens actually, it removes these two faces and extrudes a new surface in between. Now think about this one, like an alias is basically skinning those corners and then trimming the opening part out. Pretty nifty. Okay, now this part here is open. And I'm going to do the following. I'm going to B select those faces. And now, hold on. Don't want to overcomplicate this one. Yeah, let's do it that way. I select all this, press Shift D, and you see I can freely move it around. Okay. Enough fun. this face and this face. I press X and say delete face. Just delete the face because it removes the filling. If I remove the vertices, whoops, this stuff happens. Okay. And then here and here, I delete the face as well. Okay. Switch snapping to vertex. And then I press G and see if it snaps to anything here. Oh, maybe. Oh, there, look. Ah, oh, perfect match. So you see, actually, I did not try to snap to here because I saw that actually it tries to snap this part first. So I simply snapped to there. Now, if I move this one, it is not stitched together. You see, it's loose. So what I have to do is a, and then I go to tools and say remove doubles. And I should be for 8, there, 8. And here were 8 vertices, which were always alone. And what I mean is like here, this point and this point and this point at this point from each surface they had something there, and I just needed to remove those. Do I have a face? Oh yeah, I have a face internally here, and delete. What about you? And delete. Okay, I think I didn't do that. Okay, now this is still open, so we need to patch it. So what I can do, shift click those points and simply say F for fill, or go to face, fill, zip. I need to select 4 points, 4 edges, it's closed, F filled, perfect. See, now this, for example, looks like a totally sturdy, solid part. Now, why did I do this? For example, now for presentation purpose, I could create this a bevel. I could add a bevel to it, maybe 0.25 inches. Zoom in a little bit. Now you see this is kind of like a chamfer. Is there a scale factor? Oh, there's a scale factor. You see the bevel is kind of wonky. And that's because I have a scale factor running. So, okay, object, apply. Scale, zip, and that's the way how it should look like. Okay, maybe I want to have this to be a fillet and not a chamfer. More segments, and you see then it looks nice and rounded. So that's not too bad for presentation purpose. That's pretty sufficient. So for example, Alt H brings my top plate back. This one I would like to give a small bevel as well. So similar to, for example, how the timeline in Fusion works. I have a sketch or a plane and I extrude or solidify it, give a thickness, and then the next step, this geometry, I can give a small bevel. 0.25 there, maybe 10 or so, don't want to overdo it, maybe 0.1 inch. Okay. And this bevel, for example, provides a really nice highlight. Pay attention to, for example, down there, if I turn this one off, looks boring, looks much better. Okay, so that is basically everything for the crash course in how to move and rotate objects, how to create some basic geometry. There is actually one last thing I would like to go a little more into detail right now before I call this good. You actually have, for example, here a widget for move, rotate, and scale. can also turn the widget on and off. So for example, let's shift D, move this one to here. And then I rotate this one. You see this one has a rotation of 25 degrees. And then here you have global and here you have local. So the same thing like in Alias. So you see now I can move in local space. I can rotate in local space. Pretty convenient. I can even scale locally. So you see there's actually a lot of overlap and similarity. Now let's pay attention to this 3D cursor. That's actually really interesting. So with the right mouse button, you can actually position it. And I mentioned before that whenever I create something at that plane, at that position, the object is being placed. Now in Alias, if you want to scale to something, then we set the point accordingly. And Blender is a little bit more forgiving. So for example, I select those two. And when I scale, you see they scale towards each other. Maybe let's create another one here. Scale, okay. If I rotate them, you see like where the widget is, that's where it rotates around. Right now, I have, for example, bounding box. So bounding box like a big box around and it centers to that scale. I could actually have individual origins. This is actually quite nifty. See, it scales to each object alone. Active element, everything scales to the active object or rotates around it. And here, one of my favorite tools, if I go to the 3D cursor, see it scales to the 3D cursor. Whee! Or rotates around it. Okay. So the 3D cursor, we can actually, like in Alias, position as well. But there actually Alias has the upper hand again with its interface. Blender is a little bit more not ideal, but still very usable. So for example, I would like my 3D cursor to snap, let's say, to this point. Then I could go to Object, Edit, click this point, and then say Shift S. That opens the snap command, and I could say snap the cursor to the selected CV. Zip, you see, there it is. Now what Alias cannot do, if I select these two objects, I could say snap to the distance between these two lines. So that, for example, is pretty nice. Or for example, if I select all these points, Shift S, it snaps to kind of like the geometrical center of my selection. So that's actually pretty convenient. So for example, in there, I could rotate right, you see, around that part. Okay, so I will leave it at this for the moment to show you how Blender works and also provide you with some similarities to how, for example, Alias works. And you will see the more you work with it, there's actually a really nice overlap between all those programs.